On the screen, you will find the pictures of certain regular appliances. Over here, you will see a table fan. Over here, a washing machine. And this one is a juicer. Now, there is one common aspect in all these three appliances, even though their functions might be completely different. The common aspect is that they have a certain part which rotates. In the table fan, as you can see, the blades rotate, and these rotating blades give us the air. In the washing machine, there are also certain kinds of blades that rotate and ensure that the clothes placed in them get washed efficiently. And similar manner, in the juicer, there are certain blades which are responsible for reducing the fruits to their pulp and thus bringing out the juice from these fruits. So in all these things, there is a certain part that rotates. Now this rotation is made possible because all of these are electrical appliances. So the moment we supply electricity, electric current flows through these appliances and the blades start rotating. Do you know the name of the device that is used for these rotating parts? Such a device is known as electric motor. So the basic function of an electric motor is to rotate. Now, this particular rotation function is achieved because we are applying electricity and the motor rotates, thereby fulfilling the functionality of whichever appliance we consider. So let us now study in details about the electric motor and what is the basic structure of an electric motor. Now in this animation, you will find a very simple schematic of an electric motor. This is an electric motor in action. As you can see, current is flowing through the motor and the motor is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. So now let us study in details about how this motor is able to rotate and what exactly is going on inside it. So now let us look at the top view of the motor. In this top view, it will be easier for you to understand the construction of the motor. Now as you can see, there is a presence of a north pole and a south pole, indicating that there is a magnet inside the motor. Within the poles of this magnet is placed the armature coil ABCD. Now in common applications of the motor, this armature coil ABCD is usually wound around a soft iron core. Now two ends of this coil at A and D are connected to a split ring. Now this split ring is so called because, as the name suggests, there is a split. So if you consider a ring like this and if you split it in two, you will get two parts like this, and this is exactly what is placed over here. So we consider the split rings S1 and S2 at which ends A and D of the armature coil are connected. Now S1 is connected or is touched against carbon brush B1 and S2 is touched against carbon brush B2. Now these carbon brush act as leads for the battery across which the entire circuit is connected. So across B1, the positive of the battery is connected, and across B2, the negative of the battery is connected. And this entire arrangement is kept in a casing. So as you can see from the polarity on the battery, current will flow in this particular direction. Now if you consider arms AB and CD separately, you will find that the direction of current in both these arms is perpendicular to the direction of the external magnetic field. So there will be a certain force that acts on them. So since arms AB and CD are perpendicular, the direction of current being perpendicular to the applied magnetic field, there will be a certain force that acts on them. However, if you consider arms BC and AD, in these arms, the current direction is parallel to that of the magnetic field, as you can see. So due to this, no force will act on those two arms. So because in arms BC and DA, the direction of current is parallel to the magnetic field, no force acts on arms BC and DA. Now I want you to consider arms AB and CD and how we can calculate the force on them using Fleming's left-hand rule. So firstly, consider arm AB. I told you that the direction of current is in this manner. So in arm AB, I first take the index finger pointing in the direction of the magnetic field, and then I outstretch my middle finger pointing in the direction of current along AB. Now if I stretch out my thumb such that it is perpendicular to both the index as well as middle finger, I will find that it gives me the direction of force acting on AB. In this case, it is into the plane of the screen. So on arm AB, a force acts, which we obtain from Fleming's left-hand rule, which is into the plane of the screen. The force acting on arm AB is into the plane. Now let us consider arm CD. Again, I will show you the direction of the currents. Now in arm CD, current is flowing in the downward direction. So again, my index finger will point towards the direction of magnetic field, and current that is depicted by the middle finger points downwards. So if I stretch out my thumb in a manner perpendicular to both my middle finger as well as index finger, I find that the force acting on CD is out of the plane of the screen, or in this manner. Thus, the force acting on arm CD is out of the plane of the screen, whereas the force acting on AB is into the plane of the screen. Now we see that the amount of current flowing through arm AB and CD is the same, because the current that was flowing through these is coming from the same battery. Also, the same external magnetic field is acting on them, because they have been kept within the north and south pole of the same magnet. So if both the current and external magnetic field is the same, what can we say? We can say that the force that acts on them will also be equal. Now, as you saw, the force acting on them, despite being equal, were not acting in the same direction. In fact, they were acting one in the inward and one in the outward direction. Or in other words, they were acting in the opposite directions and not along the same line. Does that ring a bell somewhere? That means the force acting on arms AB and CD are equal, opposite, and also not along the same line of action, and due to this reason, they form a couple. Now, the moment a couple is formed on arms AB and CD, it will rotate, and quite rightly so, the coil ABCD begins to rotate as you saw. So due to this couple that has been generated, as you can see, the armature coil begins to rotate. Now if you look closely, you will find that a time comes when the split rings lose contact with the carbon brushes. This is because the split rings, even though they are in contact with the carbon brushes, are not fixed with it. So while rotating, there comes a time when there is no contact in between the carbon brushes and the split rings. So this is such an instance when the coil, after having rotated in the anti-clockwise direction, has come to a point when there is no contact in between B1 and S1 and even B2 and S2. So due to this reason, as you can see, the circuit breaks. Now the moment circuit breaks, no current will flow inside the entire circuit, and as a result, because the circuit is broken, no current flows through the coil. And the moment current does not flow through the coil, there will be no force acting on the coil. Now, what do you think exactly happens over here? The moment the circuit is broken, do you think the armature comes to an abrupt stop? Well, obviously not, right? Because then the entire purpose of the motor, that is to rotate and fulfill the functionality of the appliance, would be defeated. So what exactly do you think happens in this case? Despite the fact that there is no contact in between the split rings and the carbon brushes, due to inertia of rotational motion, the coil does not stop suddenly. That is, the coil does not immediately stop, but rather carries on rotating due to the inertia of rotational motion. So let's see where this inertia of rotational motion carries the coil next. So now, after rotation, S2 comes in contact with B1 and S1 comes in contact with B2. Now, if you consider the direction of current, you will find that it flows in the direction DCBA. Or in other words, from D to C and then from B to A. Now, if you consider it with the previous case, you will find that despite the fact current direction remains same, it has reversed in the sense that previously it was flowing from AB, then from C to D, whereas now it is flowing from DC, then from B to A. So this reversal in this sense is caused due to the fact that we are using a split ring. This particular arrangement is also known as the split ring commutator. So what is the purpose of the split ring commutator? The purpose of the split ring commutator are twofold. The first purpose is to ensure that the force acts in the same anti-clockwise direction, or in other words, the couple that acts in the anti-clockwise direction. And secondly, the split ring commutator also ensures that despite the fact current direction remains the same, it reverses in the sense that previously it was flowing in ABCD, now it is flowing as DCBA. So due to this, the couple that acts remains in the same direction and it ensures a uniform flow of the armature coil. Now consider arms DC and BA. Firstly, we consider arm DC. I place my index finger in a manner to depict the direction of the magnetic field, and I place my middle finger in a manner to depict the direction of current along DC. So now if I stretch out my thumb so that it is perpendicular to both the index finger as well as the middle finger, I will find that the force acting on DC is acting in the downward direction. Force on arm DC acts in the downward direction. Now let us consider what happens at arm BA. Again, in a similar manner, I place my index finger pointing in the direction which the magnetic field is pointed towards, and I place my middle finger in the direction of current along arm BA. Now if I stretch out my thumb in a manner so that it is perpendicular to both the index as well as the middle finger, I will find that the force acting on arm BA is in the upward direction. So due to this reason, the forces that act on arms DC and BA are again forming a couple which is anti-clockwise, just like we saw in the previous case where the forces acting on AB and CD formed an anti-clockwise couple. So over here, when current is in the direction DCBA, the couple that is being formed by the two equal and opposite forces are an anti-clockwise couple. And due to this reason, the coil keeps on rotating. Now consider another scenario where there is again no contact in between S2 and B1 and B2 and S1. So over here, again the circuit is broken because the carbon brushes have lost contact with the split rings. So do you think the coil comes to an abrupt stop? Well, obviously not. Despite the fact that no current is flowing in the coil and there is no force acting on the coil, due to inertia of motion, the coil will continue to rotate. So we find, just like in the previous case, the coil does not come to an abrupt stop, but due to the inertia of rotational motion, the coil continues to rotate. So we find that when electric current passes through a conductor placed normally in a magnetic field, a force acts on the conductor. And due to this, the conductor begins to move. Now the moment the conductor is moving, it means it has some sort of a mechanical energy. Now when mechanical energy is possessed by a moving body, it is termed as kinetic energy. So this implies that the conductor has mechanical energy in the form of kinetic energy. So when we are feeding in electricity or electrical energy into the DC motor, we find that it is being converted into kinetic energy, which is a kind of mechanical energy. Thus, electrical energy is getting converted into mechanical energy. Now, current is applied to the circuit in one direction only. Or in other words, the battery that we had considered supplied current in one particular direction, and this direction remained fixed throughout the operation of the motor. So since the current direction is fixed, we can say that this is a direct current or a DC motor which converts electrical energy into mechanical energy. So why exactly is it known as direct current? Direct current or DC is so termed because there is a constant flow of electrons in one particular direction. Or in other words, the flow of electrons and thereby the flow of current does not change. It remains constant in one particular direction. And also the fact that the current that is supplied is of constant magnitude. So in DC, two things remain the same. One is the magnitude of the current, and second is the direction in which current flows. So we find that the common electrical motor that is normally used is also known as the DC motor, because as I told you, it supplies current in the same direction, current is supplied in one particular direction, and the magnitude of current also remains the same throughout the operation of the DC motor. And since it converts electrical energy to mechanical energy, we can say that the DC motor is one such appliance which is responsible for converting electrical to mechanical energy. That is, the moment electricity is applied, the coil starts to rotate, and thereby we obtain mechanical energy. And this DC motor is the motor that is commonly used in fans, juicers, as well as washing machines, and in many other appliances.